How many of you are going above Java 11 at the moment? Nobody? Oh, okay. Tough crowd, huh? So yeah, I'm Raghav. I'm the Java guy at DeepSource. I'm here to talk about, you know, some new features that have come out since Java 14. There's been a lot of, you know, really nice innovation. The features that I'm most going to talk about are sealed classes and interfaces, records, and also pattern matching using, you know, both if and switch statements. So basically, like, as you have some history, you know, like records started out in around Java 14, first preview, and they iterated on it in the next version after that. And then it got released on Java 16. Sealed classes are a very exciting thing because they let you do something which you haven't really been able to do in Java. It's a type of pattern known as, you know, some pattern, some types. So that's a functional programming term. And records, which, you know, it's just Lombok classes, like, you know, data classes, except done a bit better, you know. And their records are technically what you can call a product type. So you've now have the ability, since I think Java 19, to really do sum and product types in a better way. So let me tell you a bit about, you know, these things. You know, like, whether it's sum and product, what does that even mean, you know? So sum type is basically just when you want a choice between different things, you know, you might want to choose between, say, let's say an example. Imagine an event or something that you want to process. Like, you know, you've got your, this is in Rust, by the way, but hopefully it tells you how things work. So imagine you have two different types of events. You want to either print something or you have a file that you want to work with. So in Rust, at least, what would happen is you can choose, you know, between whether you want to choose what to do when you want to, you know, process a file and when you want to process something to print. So that is the essence of a sum type. The fact that you have a choice, you want to represent that, and you want to say how to handle it when you come to the choice. Now, in Java, sealed classes can do that job for you. And, you know, this is what it looks like. You see here that this is like, you know, the analog of enum event. And then each of these are the variants of that enum. So in this case, it's just inheritance. These classes inherit from event itself to have file and print. So, you know, why would you want sealed classes, first of all? Because you can already sort of do this thing. Like, this structure over here doesn't look too different from, you know, what you saw in the last slide. You just have, you know, you have three different classes. They're all final because you don't want anybody extending these further, let's imagine. And, you know, you have your interface over here. This is what everything is in the end, logically. But there is this one pesky thing that your users can do, which is to just, you know, run away with your code. They just go ahead and do something you completely do not expect. Like, let's say there's some Tesla enthusiast who's like, yeah, I need a space roadster in my, you know, abstraction for celestial objects. So what are we going to do about that? You know, like, we can't just say this interface is package private or it's private. Not always. Maybe we can sometimes, but not always. So sealed classes provide a way out for that. What we can do is, so now celestial is sealed. And I'll come to this part later. But now, because celestial is sealed, it cannot be inherited beyond, you know, what is in this area. If a user tries to, you know, create another subtree class of Celestial, this will be an error in Java code. Java will not like this set of. And so the reason for that is this sealed thing over here. Now, you can technically, so when it comes to sealed classes, you have three different modifiers you can have for the subtypes. You can have final, which means like, you know, this thing can have multiple variants, but you don't want any variants for planet. You don't want any variants for comet. Now we come to the star, which also implements sealed, celestial rather. And star is also a sealed class. Why? Because, you know, you can have different types of stars in our abstraction. So we have dwarf stars, we have red giants. So Java has given us a way to, you know, represent hierarchies of choices, essentially. And now, you know, what about, you know, the other thing I talked about, which was product types. So we have records now. And as I said before, records are just, you know, easier, you know, more convenient ways to define data classes, POJOs or DTOs, anything. You can use a record for anything where you just want some data to be held somewhere. You don't really want to, you know, make a big fuss about it. It has no behavior associated. So a record class, you know, it's very simple. You don't need a body, right? You don't need a constructor even. Like, constructors are automatically generated for you. And all fields are private and final. So that means that, you know, you will not have a setter for ID and title. You will only have a getter. These fields are implicitly set when the object is actually created. You know, like, this is like basically, it desugars to, you know, a bit more Java code, but I don't have that in the slides. You can take a look under Java P or something if you want to see how it looks. So, you know, you can still define some behavior for it. Like, you know, we can have in the record body itself, like, not that this body over here is empty, but we can put stuff inside it. So we can have instance methods, static methods, anything you want. So yeah, that's about record classes really. But, you know, our use cases for this, the main one I'm focusing on is functional data structures. And I mean, I may be wrong in some ways, like I may be saying misinformation, please don't hesitate to like just raise your hand and correct me if I'm wrong. But essentially what we want to do is we want to, you know, take a look at what new things you can do in Java with these. So first thing that, you know, I'm talking about is optional. Now, Java 7, I think, I introduced optionality, which is an attempt to get try to, you know, fix the $1 billion mistake. But I don't think it really works, because, you know, you can still have a nullable optional. You can just say optionality equals null. And technically, the way that optional works is it just has this, you know, private final t value. So it just has this value in here. Like, look at this. An empty optional is just an optional with a null value in it. And optional even says, like, you know, it has two different static factory methods. It has optional.off, which would give you, you know, your usual... either it has an it has three in it, or it has nothing in it. But it also does have optional.off nullable. So basically, like, you can straight up lose the whole point of optional. Because the whole point was that, you know, you wanted to represent something that could be null or not without using null. But straight up, you can just have null values anyway. But anyway, this is how you would use option. So, like, you know, you can check if something is present in it. And you can, you know, call this code and you won't get a no such element exception, technically. But maybe there's a better way to do it, you know. You can still run into a lot of pitfalls. And it would be, Java recently introduced these things such as pattern matching and switch and stuff. It would be nice to, you know, be able to elegantly express, you know, this case if optional dot is present. So why is it nice? Yeah, it really does look nice. But you can only really make use of it in Java 19+. How many of you are going above Java 11 at the moment? Nobody? Oh, okay. Tough crowd, huh? Okay. Well, I mean, I don't blame you, like, Java Enterprise, it all goes hand in hand. But yeah, so pattern matching is something that really only works in Java 19 at the moment. Probably Java 20, 21 would introduce refinements to it, but if you're not on newer versions, you're not going to get anything good. You know, you can have some space savings with functional patterns. Like, for example, optional is always going to have this, you know, have to allocate space for this reference that you may or may not really have. You know, if this value is always going to be null, then you're just going to have this, you know, extra 4 bytes for the reference sitting around all over the place. So, you know, there's a way out around that. And that is, you know, oh, wait, a second. I will show you what an optional looks like in, you know, our new functional version of optional. So what we do is we have a sealed interface here, which permits some or none. Now, some represents the case where, you know, you have an object actually inside it. And you will see that you have some default values. This is like just to mimic the original Java interface somehow. So, you know, you can have a none, optional.none. So that looks like this. You know, you just throw a exception. And if it has a sum, you know, have a value. Now note that the, you know, the actual variants of optional are sum, which has a t value. Oh, let's get that away. T value. And none doesn't have anything. It's just an empty record. So this lets us do stuff like this. Yeah, okay, that should be. So you can have, like, you know, an optional.sum. And I can actually run this. Give me a second. Java scratch one. Oh, forgot to compile. Now, one thing is that I actually need to enable preview features. This is like the latest Java, Java 19. Enable preview features, you know, and I have to set up some extra arguments over here because otherwise Java hates you. This should work, yeah. And now if I say Java scratch one, so it printed false, true, 4 and 4. What does that mean? So first, we checked if optional is null. It wasn't, so it printed false. It checked if it was sum. Yeah, it printed true. And it tried getting the optional. It printed 4. And after that, I tried doing some switch-based pattern matching. This is like a very new feature, by the way. Like, literally preview, I think like first or second preview is in Java 19. So this is where, you know, you can basically, given a record, what you can do is you can extract the values within the record and use them from, you know, within the case itself. So now I can directly use IE. I don't need to, like, you know, unpack, like, I don't need to say opt.get I or whatever. I can just straight up say integer I. And this is a local variable within the case. So now this is why, you know, you have your second 4 printed. Now let's look at a different case, you know, of scratch2.java. And over here, I have a null value. Over here, what do you think? Can you give me some guesses as to what, you know, you're going to get over here and what you're going to get in this switch case? Any guesses, anyone? An exception? No. And what about the switch case over here? Which, you know, path is it going to take? Okay. Let's try it out. I'm sorry? The first one. Let's try it out. This is going to be very surprising. It printed out the gibberish, which it really shouldn't have. Like, going by normal Java, you know, normal Java rules, it really shouldn't be printing this, right? You'd expect it to print, you know, it would print a null value over here, right? Isn't that what you would expect? But it doesn't. This prints fine. As you said, it prints null. But over here, it jumps to the default. Let me show you one last example, which will maybe give you some idea of what's going on. Let me shrink this down a bit. Now over here, note the types on the type parameters. Here it is integer. Over here, it is the question mark, wildcard. So if I switch using wildcard, it actually does the right thing. Technically, semantically speaking, it should do the right thing and print default because, here this integer is null, right? You don't want to, do anything if you have null values. So, it does sort of the right thing and it prints the gibberish. But if you try print using the scratch 3 instead, let me do that. Scratch 3. Here you go, null, null. So, for some reason, Java thinks that, it's okay as long as, I have this integer over here. It's okay to assume that I want a nullable value over here, and it'll actually print null. Very weird. But, it's still it's still in preview, so it doesn't matter too much. They'll change the behavior. But yeah, we're using Java 19 preview features. This stuff is not available on older versions. It requires exhaustive pattern matching. So let me show you what can happen if I do not have, say, a case, default case. Now, technically speaking, technically we don't need the default case because opt can never be null. Hopefully, opt is not null over here at all. And opt can only have two types. It can be either sum or it can be none. But if I print and compile this, give me a second. Yeah, Java gave me an error because apparently, I have not covered all possible inputs. So one thing that happens is Java wants exhaustive pattern matching. Java wants you to at least give it a default case so it can, decide that, I don't know what to do here. So stuff like that. And also generic types need to be mentioned. Java will not compile this code with raw types. So, you can't do case sum. So, already it gives you an error saying it's a raw type, but Java straight up won't compile this. Yeah, one error. Raw deconstruction patterns are not allowed. So that's another thing. No. So ideally, I guess if you're ever going to use this feature, go with this version where you use wildcard everywhere. I don't know if wildcard is really a good idea, but it's how it's designed right at the moment. So make sure to use the right thing.
So the use of integer
yeah.
Exactly goes to default case. Is there anything that goes to default case?
Oh, in the default case, I'm guessing what happens is if opt itself is null, let's try that. That's obvious. So let me maybe comment these out. Yeah, it doesn't. And that's one of the sad things about how Java is right now. We don't have mandatory null checkness. So technically we have something on the way, right? We have Project Valhalla, which is an interesting project, effort to get value types in Java. And I urge you guys to, maybe Google it, see what it actually is, because it's a very interesting thing. But let me actually compile this again and run this. Okay, it said null pointer exception again. On the switch case. Oh, that's because I didn't give it a null pattern. Let me do that. You can also do this in Java 19. Case null. The compiler doesn't really warn you about it at all. Oh, I can't vim. Let's try this. And I'm gonna have to say Okay, let's just do this. This is going to work. Yeah, I just printed null because it went to this first case. It made sure. So yeah, one fourth observation is that switch will give you an error on null unless you specifically handle the null case. So that is something that the new preview features do. So, you know, now let's talk about some exception handling. Yeah, we want exception handling. It is nice to have errors stuff, but you know, I personally hate exceptions so much. I really don't like the way, you know, they play around with your control flow. You know, you have all your try, catch, and then finally, and you do not want to know how complex the rules behind how finally gets executed are. Believe me, I know. So, you know, there's no other way in Java except exceptions, right? But maybe you can do something better. So, you know, in other languages like Rust or Go, errors are just normal types. Like, you know, you can just assign an error to a value. Of course, you can do that in Java too, but Java errors are special. You can throw them. You can't throw stuff around in Rust or Go, I think. So, you know, in Go, it looks like this. You know, you've got your thing. But one big fatal problem, I feel, in Go is that you are free to ignore the error completely. You can straight up just delete this if statement, and Go doesn't care. You're just free to, you know, use F and, I don't know, panic, I guess. Now, Rust, I like how Rust does it better. Rust represents its errors in an enum. Like I showed you option before, Rust also has a result enum, which has two values, okay and error. So okay, what it does is, you know, it represents your success case, and then you will have your, you know, whatever value is your success value, you can use that, and error is your error value. And notice that there's no special error type that is enforced. These are just type parameters, like, you know, generic types. They can be anything. So, you know, if you were to do that somewhat similar thing, this is shamelessly copied from tutorial point, I think. So, you know, you have this fallible operation, main.jpg doesn't exist. But, you know, if we have success somehow, you know, you can get the value within the result. This is a result. It's not typed because it's inferred. And you can print it out. But that's not going to happen. We're going to get an error here because apparently it doesn't exist. So, you know, we can do whatever we want with the error as well. And this concept is something, you know, people have referred to it as railway-oriented programming, where, you know, if you are successful at something, you want to keep going forward. You know, it's like doing, you know, you might have done, you know, sort of a precondition-based exits. You might say, on one condition, you'll want to, say, throw an exception or return null or return your default value, error value, somehow. And on another condition, keep throwing things. And then below all that comes your actual logic that does the right thing. So that's known as railway-oriented programming. And so we can do something similar. We don't want to throw exceptions though. And we can create Rust-style result values in Java. Basically, here's the code for that. So I have only one example over here for it, but it'll show you, you know, the guts. Go ahead. Now, result looks sort of similar to option. You know, you have two extra things over here. You have get and get error. For if you want to raise an error, then, you know, if you're sure that, you know, your result is an error, you can use get error. If you're sure that your result is okay, then you can use get. And, you know, you have your factory methods, and you have your methods to check whether it's one or the other. So, okay is implemented like this, error is implemented like this. This looks very similar to optional. And note that, you know, on okay, get is defined correctly, and get error just throws an exception. And in the similar way,
it's sort of switched around for error. So how do we use these things? Okay, ignore this. But let's say that, you know, we have two fallible functions. Fallible bad just straight up returns an error. Fallible good returns. Okay. So it looks pretty much the same. And now I had wanted to show if statements with pattern matching as well, but looks like I didn't really do that. But this looks very much the same as with optional handling again. But it sort of gives you an idea of what you can do with it. Now, in Java, we don't have some of the syntactic sugar that we have in other functional languages. Like in some languages, like Rust, you can make it seem as if you never do any error handling. Because literally you have this question mark operator, which will say that, okay, if there is any error at any point, just exit out. But in Rust, we have to, because we don't have that, technically that similar kind of thing, a pattern would be the throw that you saw earlier on. This would be the same pattern. But in Java, if you want to use these kind of functional abstractions, you have to sort of do some, you have to deal with some unsavory looking code. And let's just see what this prints. So scratch 4. What's happened here is, we first have your, normal case. It's okay, this is true, this is false. This returns nice. And we can print, we can extract and print out the value. For the second result, we basically get an exception. Got exception code, find it. And if you say res.getError, it returns the error. So I guess what Java does is Java automatically throws an exception if it gets returned as a value. So that's what's happened here. So yeah, basically that's a short tour of some interesting things you can do with error handling and stuff in Java. Thank you for listening.